author and horror news contributor William Burke back with another cult movie double bill. If you're trying to figure out the connection between these two films, don't worry, we'll get to that. First up is probably the most controversial film we'll cover. It's 1932's Freaks. A scheming trapeze artist, aided by her strongman lover, plots to seduce and marry a love-struck little person, then poison him to obtain his inherited fortune. But her plans are foiled by the little person's surrogate family of vengeful sideshow performers, the titular Freaks.
Let her try doing anything to one of us.
Some films are legendary box office failures, but director Tod Browning's Freaks took that to its extreme. The film horrified the public and outraged critics, with one reviewer declaring, "Anyone who considers this entertainment should be placed in the pathological ward of some hospital." That's harsh. In truth, Freaks never exploits its title characters. Director Browning presents them with compassion, stressing that, despite their disabilities, these are human beings with dignity who deserve our respect, not our pity. One reason Browning's compassion was so heartfelt was because he lived it. At age 16, Browning did the most old-timey thing imaginable by running away to join the circus. He started out as a roustabout before eventually becoming a clown for Ringling Brothers. Despite finding success as a film director, the circus was still in his blood. Many of his early silent films revolved around circus performers and physical disability, most notably the 1927 Lon Chaney vehicle, The Unknown. As a director, Browning earned a reputation for being reliable and innovative, but in 1931, he truly struck gold with the first sound horror film.
I am Dracula.
Dracula's success gave Browning a blank check to do whatever project he chose, which led to Freaks, a decision he'd come to regret. Freaks' standout characters include conjoined twins Daisy and Violet Hilton, whose complex sex life is hinted at, and the remarkably agile but legless Johnny Eck, who runs on his hands. And the armless Francis O'Connor, professionally known as the Living Venus de Milo. The romantically entwined little people are actually played by brother and sister Harry and Daisy Earls. Freaks also presents cinema's first overtly trans character in performer Josephine Joseph.
Living, breathing monstrosity, Josephine Joseph, half woman, half man.
Have a cigar, Joseph.
You dropped your lipstick, Josephine.
Don't get her sore or he'll butt you in the nose.
Despite being mocked on screen by some lungheads, the character is treated with respect. Josephine Joseph runs afoul of macho circus strongman Hercules, but there's a subtle hint to them having a past he refuses to acknowledge. It's all remarkably accepting for its time. While the sideshow performers are considered freaks, the real monsters are the physically beautiful people, Cleopatra and Hercules.
They're going to make you one of them, my peacock.
The only non-sideshow characters who display decency are Madame Tetralini, who serves as the performer's surrogate guardian, along with the clown Frozo, and animal trainer Venus, who share a budding romance. Quick note, this is another pre-code movie, meaning characters drink and have premarital relationships. In other words, they act like real people.
You think because she's so beautiful and I'm just a man?
Don't hurt. Please. To me, you're a man, but to her, you're only something to laugh at.
Freaks is light years ahead of its time, which is probably why it failed. Browning presented the title characters as human beings, something the public wasn't ready for.
We didn't lie to you, folks. We told you we had living, breathing monstrosities. But for the accident of birth, you might be even as they are.
But there's a darker reason that freaks met with so much abuse. In 1931, America was swept up in the pseudoscience of eugenics. Doctors and politicians preached the doctrine of forced sterilization for those deemed unfit to bear children.
Come on, Venus, the bearded lady's baby's born!
Browning's presentation of people with disabilities, displaying dignity and self-reliance, and even having children, flew directly in the face of this propaganda.
Your parents have added their consent to the orders of this court and the recommendations of the State Medical Commission.
Stuart, you are to be transferred to one of the safe hospitals for immediate sterilization.
So you tell me who the real monsters were. Freaks destroyed director Tod Browning's career. After a few lesser films, he became an alcoholic recluse, dying in 1962.
They'll make her one of us, a loving cop, a loving cop.
Freaks shouldn't be considered a horror movie. Ultimately, it's a film about inclusivity and acceptance, concepts that still scare people today. And if you're looking for genuine horror thrills, check out my novels, Dominant Species, Primeval Waters, and Scorpius Rex.
How she got that way will never be known. Some say a jealous lover. Others, that it was the code of the freaks. Others, the storm. Believe it or not, there she is.
Through me, you go among people lost. Abandon hope, all ye who wish.
Entrance to hell.
Our second feature is a rare example of 1970s grindhouse sleaze done with all the gloss and star power of a major studio. A young woman moves into a building that's really the gateway to hell. Nope, it's not the beyond. It's 1977's The Sentinel. The Exorcist and The Omen had been blockbusters, leaving 70s audiences hungry for the next big-budget rematch between Satan and the Catholic Church.
There is danger.
At that time, director Michael Winner was riding high after a trio of hits starring Charles Bronson. Their third blockbuster, Death Wish, invented the vigilante genre. Fearing he was being pigeonholed as an action director, Winner signed on to rewrite and direct The Sentinel. The Sentinel was adapted from Jeffrey Konvitz's paperback bestseller. The resulting screenplay was a pastiche of ideas cribbed from The Exorcist, Rosemary's Baby, and The Omen, with an abundance of plot holes. Horror was a genre that Winner never seemed to wrap his head around. Previously, he'd been able to punch up the first and second acts of his films with car chases, shootouts, and Charles Bronson's raw charisma. Those ballistic elements were replaced with our heroine Allison apartment hunting.
People are standing in line for this.
Where? Don't call us, we'll call you.
Eventually, Allison rents a palatial Brooklyn apartment in a building full of eccentric tenants. Unfortunately, we're already hitting the 20-minute mark with no sense of impending dread.
I want you to meet Allison Potts.
And this is where we can start to draw comparisons to Freaks. One pair of tenants are queer women who are portrayed as perverted degenerates.
What do you do for a living?
We fondle each other. Fondle.
A far cry from Freaks' sympathetic trans person.
My dear Miss Parker, aside from the priest and now, of course, you, nobody has lived in that building for 3 years.
I get that they're supposed to be ghosts, but using their sexuality to repulse us feels like a giant cultural step backward. Thankfully, at the 40-minute mark, the Sentinel kicks into high gear when Allison has a ghoulish encounter with her dead father. This is also when makeup effects legend Dick Smith finally steps up to the plate, creating a terrifying ghostly apparition. Smith created some of cinema's greatest makeup effects, mentoring the likes of Rick Baker, Kevin Haney, and Craig Reardon along the way. Clearly, Smith was the go-to guy when it came to creating ungodly hordes from hell. But Winner, for either economic or creative reasons, took a different approach for the film's climax. It was a poor and insensitive choice. Instead of using makeup effects, Winner cast people with deformities to portray the legions of hell.
I call it!
Unlike Tod Browning, Winner cast these deformed people solely for their shock value. The fact that they were treated with disgust by crew members makes the whole affair even more distasteful. Not cool. It's really too bad, because the Sentinel offers some gleefully trashy 70s thrills, excellent makeup effects, and an amazing cast of Hollywood veterans and new faces. Chris Sarandon, fresh off his Oscar-winning turn in Dog Day Afternoon, is the male lead, complete with a villainous mustache. Universal Pictures took a cue from its hit disaster movies by casting a fleet of marquee value Hollywood stars, including Martin Balsam, John Carradine, Jose Ferrer, Arthur Kennedy, Burgess Meredith, William Hickey,
take a high chance,
and Eli Wallach.
From Baltimore?
Yes.
How nice. I find New Yorkers have no sense for anything but sex and money.
Ava Gardner is the real standout. She casually waltzes onto the screen and shows all the new kids how the pros do it.
Shaking your hair in the fields. Oh, it must be a glamorous profession.
But the Sentinel really shines in its supporting roles, with a plethora of then unknowns like Christopher Walken, Jeff
Quick,
Goldblum,
give me the other camera. I'm not going to get it like this again.
Jerry Orbach.
Unbelievable. All right, we'll use take 10. Allison, take a break.
Beverly D'Angelo. Nana Visitor. And even Tom Berenger. After its short theatrical run, The Sentinel became an HBO staple. As a kid, I thought it was amazing. Now that I'm older, uglier, and at least slightly wiser, its use of actual deformed people as monsters leaves me wanting to take a shower. Michael Winner made some great films, but sadly, The Sentinel's finale proved he was no Tod Browning. Final verdict? The Sentinel is a fun one-hour movie with 30 minutes of meandering apartment hunting tacked onto the front.
Oh, Jesus, Allison, another unfurnished apartment. With all the stuff you have to buy.
Well, at least I can get a full-length mirror.
So, if you're craving some 1970s weirdness, give it a shot.
Black and white cat, black and white cake.
More great films are coming, so like and subscribe so you don't miss them. Hey, if you're looking for horror thrills that don't exploit people, check out my novels. And as always, thanks for watching.